in this chapter, Kingdom of Fools, what we have read about the strange rule made by the king as well as the minister. And when the guru and the disciple, they have arrived at kingdom, they have come to know that this is a kingdom of fools. Okay, why? Because the days were changed into nights and the nights were changed into days. And just because of this reason, people were also so annoyed. They were also not ready to follow these orders. But ultimately, this was the order by the king. Whosoever is not going to follow the rule, they will be executed till death. Right? Then afterwards, what happened? One day, the guru and the disciple, when they arrived, they also found that everything was just sold for one dudu. That is quite a cheap price. The disciple was very happy to live there, as he was fond of eating. He was happy with the availing all the things at such a low price. Okay, but the guru, who was far-sighted, who has magical vision also, he knew that something wrong will happen in this kingdom, because this is a kingdom of fools. So as I told you on that day, what is the main theme of this chapter is indecisiveness. Indecisiveness means to make right decisions at the right time. The guru, the minister, as well as the king, they were not able to make the right decisions at the right time. So it is just because of this reason that what has happened, that the guru knew that something wrong is going to happen. So ultimately, case came to the king's court, in which the brother of a burglar, he has come to the king to tell him that that when his brother was pursuing his ancient trade, then what happened? The wall of the merchant, it collapsed. And then what happened? The wall of the merchant, it collapsed and he was killed. So the king, in order to be just, in order to do the justice, so what he has said to call the merchant. So when the merchant was called, he has told that it was not his fault, but actually it was the fault of the bricklayer, who has not set up the proper brick so that the wall was wrongly built. So when the bricklayer was called, he was again in the same. Okay, so he was also in the same, you can say, same condition, that he said that it was not he who has done this fault, or it was not he who has made the bricks, or who has laid the bricks wrong. But ultimately, what has happened? It was a dancing girl who was moving up and down the street on that day. And after that, he was distracted. And this is the reason why now the dancing girl was also summoned to the court. You are also sitting at the last. You can come here. Or it's fine. So you can come here, right? So then afterwards, when the dancing girl, who has changed into an old woman, she came trembling to the court. And ultimately, what has happened when she came to the court? So she was asked that it was you who was dancing or who was moving along the street, and you have distracted this man. So naturally, it was she only, right? So let us see, let us read further that what will happen. Okay, so here it is going, open up your pages on the book, page number 21 also. And here it is being displayed on the screen too. So I'm writing page number 21, the last line. So you did walk up and down with your anklets jingling. You were young and you distracted him. So he built a bad wall. So the king said, you were moving up and down the street. You were coming and going, and this is the reason. The wall was wrongly built. And ultimately, what has happened? And the man was dead. It was your fault. No. Next page. It has fallen on a poor burglar. See, the king is not able to see through the things. See through the things means to find the reality. Okay. This is the reason why this is called as Kingdom of Fools. So what actually is Kingdom of Fools? Okay. Kingdom of Fools means, what is Kingdom of Fools means? When they don't have the power, right power of judgment. They don't know how to act. So he said, the poor burglar. So first of all, tell me, can burglar be a poor man? No. Can a burglar be a person to be felt pity of? No, not at all. How can he? Okay, because he is committing crimes, right? So So he said, it has fallen on a poor burglar and killed him. You have killed an innocent man. You will have to be punished. He said, you have killed an innocent man. Means he is not seeing through his crime that he is committing a crime of, you can say, burgling. Okay, crime of theft, of robbery. To rob someone's house, that is again a crime. So what he said, so you have to be punished. Now, the poor old lady, she thought for a minute and said, no, my lord, wait, I know now why I was walking up and down that street. I had given some gold to the goldsmith to make some jewelry for me. He was a lazy scoundrel. Scoundrel means? Scoundrel? Cheatable? Cheating man? Scoundrel. And he made so many excuses, said he would give it now and he would give it then, and so on all day. So, and he made me walk up and down to his house a dozen times. Dozen times means many times. Okay. So he said, sir, actually, please wait for a minute. Now I have remembered everything. Means you, if anything can be asked to you some many years ago, you cannot recall it immediately. You will take some time to recall it. So this is the reason she said, okay, just wait. Let me recall. So then she said, sir, wait. Wait, please. So it was not my fault. What excuse or what reason she has given? She said, actually, I have given a piece of jewelry to be made. I have given it to the goldsmith. And what he has done? He was such a scoundrel. He was not a loyal man. He was not a right man. He was daily telling me throughout the day, come this time, come that time. This is the reason why I was going up and down the street at different times. And he has not given it to me, that piece of jewelry, at proper time. So, and that was when this bricklayer saw me. It's not my fault, sir, my lord. It's the damned goldsmith's fault. She said, sir, just look into the matter. It was not my fault. It was at that time when I was moving up and down the street, and this man, this bricklayer, has seen me, and ultimately he was distracted. So it was not my fault that he was distracted. Why he was distracted? It is just because of the reason. Because the goldsmith made me move up and down the street. It is just because of the goldsmith I was going up and down the street. And this is the reason why this happened. Now, poor thing, she is absolutely right, thought the king. Weighing the evidence. Weighing the evidence means thinking like he is very intelligent. He was weighing down. Yes, this has been said. So this is to be done. So he said, right. She's right. This is really pity on her that it was not her fault. It was the goldsmith's fault. Now what he will do? He will call the goldsmith. We have got the real culprit at last. Finally, he said, now we have got the real culprit, who is the person who is responsible for committing this crime, and get the goldsmith wherever he is hiding at once. King ordered, just go and find the goldsmith where he is. And I want him in my court. Now, the king's bailiffs means soldiers, his men who are subordinate to him. The king's bailiffs, they searched for the goldsmith who was hiding in a corner of his shop. When he heard the accusation means allegation, blame. When he heard the accusation against him, he had his own story to tell. So now the king's bailiffs, they have searched, they have sold the soldiers. They have searched for the goldsmith everywhere. Finally, they have come to find him. So the goldsmith was found, and the bailiffs, they have told him, yes, this is the reason. He said, why you are taking me to the court? They said, you have committed this crime, that it was just because of you that a bricklayer has made a wrong wall, and the wall has fallen on a poor burglar, and you are going to be punished for that. Now, again, he was surprised. How is this possible? Now, he has his own story to tell. He has his own line of excuses to tell. So what he said, my lord, I'm a poor goldsmith. It's true. See the irony, goldsmith and poor. Again, humor added. I'm a poor goldsmith. It's true. I made this dancer come many times to my door. I gave her excuses because I couldn't finish making her jewelry before. He says, sir, I don't deny this fact that this woman, she was a young girl, she was coming to my shop again and again as she has given me a piece of jewelry to be made. Then I gave her excuses because I couldn't finish making her jewelry before I finished the rich merchant's order. So he said, sir, it's right. She was coming to my shop. But actually, the thing is that it was just because I was not able to deliver her piece of jewelry at time because I have to deliver the order of a rich merchant. It means that he has given the preference to a rich merchant. So they had a wedding coming and they wouldn't wait. You know how impatient these rich men are. He said, actually, a rich merchant, he has a wedding in his house. So he has ordered some piece of jewelry and I have to complete the order within stipulated time. And he said, sir, you know that these rich men, they can't wait anymore. So now the king, who is this rich merchant who kept you from finishing this poor woman's jewelry? Made her walk up and down, which distracted this bricklayer. So now the king said, who's that merchant who has ordered that piece of jewelry? Just call him. It was that merchant who has made the bricklayer made the wrong wall because this dancing girl, she has distracted the king. So finally, again, the matter deepens, which made a mess of this wall. Or it is just because of that merchant. Actually, he is the root cause that because of which this mess has been created. So finally, and now it has fallen on an innocent man and killed him. Can you name him? And he said, and it was just because of this rich merchant that it has fallen on an innocent man and he has now been killed. Now, he said, please tell me the name of that merchant. The goldsmith named the merchant and he was none other than the original owner of the house whose wall had fallen. So see, it has come to a complete circle. It has started from the merchant and now it has again come back to the merchant. Because it was who? It was that merchant whose wall has fallen. And he has ordered some piece of jewelry. His father has ordered, not actually he. So from where all this had started, it has come back to that place again. Again, the point is that merchant. So let us see whether the merchant is going to be punished or not. Very funny and interesting story. The goldsmith named the merchant. Now goldsmith took the name of merchant, that this was his name, and so. And he was none other than the original owner of the house whose wall had fallen. This I have told you. Now justice had come full circle. Full circle, it has come down again to the same man with whom it has been started. Thought the king, back to the merchant. Now king, again, in dilemma, what is to be done? Okay, because now it has come again to the same person from where it has started. So now, when he was rudely summoned back to the court, he arrived crying. It wasn't me, but my father who ordered the jewelry. He's dead. I'm innocent. Now, second time again, the merchant was called to the court. This time he was pleading. He was crying and he was saying, please, my lord, listen to me. It was not my fault. It was not me who has ordered that piece of jewelry. Actually, who was this? It was my father who has ordered this piece of jewelry. He said, I'm dead and I'm innocent. But the king consulted his minister and ruled decisively. But the king means he consulted his minister, ruled decisively, like he knows everything, what is right thing and what is to be done. It's true. Your father is the true murderer. He's dead. But somebody must be punished in his place. See the justice of the king as well as the minister. He said, yes, I agree that your father is dead, but in place of your father, as he was the murderer, someone has to be punished. Means it is not just because that he has committed the crime, but it is just because of this reason, because the case has been brought to the court and someone has to be punished. So was this right? No. So someone has to be punished, he said. You have inherited everything from the criminal father of yours, his riches as well as his sins, he said, because you have inherited your father's property. You have inherited everything from your father. His riches you have inherited, and so his sins. You have to pay for his sins also. Now, finally, and I knew at once, even when I first set eyes on you, that you were at the root of this horrible crime and you must die. King said, when I saw you at the first time, I came to know at that very point that you are at the actually reason. You are the root cause of this crime. That it is just because of you this has all happened. Actually, you are the problem. You are the culprit. And you must die. Now, he ordered a new stake to be made ready for the execution. Stake means it is a platform in which, you know, na, in the older times, the person is executed, cut his head and all that like this. Okay? So various forms of stakes are there. I'm not going into this history in this very morning. Okay? So, finally, he ordered, he said, a new stake is to be made where the person is to be executed. Now the orders are made by the king. The orders will be followed. As the servants sharpened the stake and got it ready for the final impaling, means killing of the criminal, it occurred to the minister that the rich merchant was somehow too thin to be properly executed on the stake. So when the stake was built, they were sharpening the stake and the final a thought came to minister. So what he said to the king, he said, dear king, I think that, he said, dear king, I think that there is a problem in the stake. Now the king said, problem? What's the problem? He said that the merchant is too thin. He won't be able to fit properly in this stake. How he will be executed? Now, he appeals to the king's common sense. And the king too worried about it. Yes, king, who was again a fool, he was worried. How can he be executed? Now see what they will do. What shall we do? He said, when suddenly it struck him that all they needed to do was to find a man fat enough to fit the stake. So finally, what they thought and thought and thought. Finally, they come to the conclusion, let us do one thing. We will find a man who will fit this stake. Ultimately, who is the criminal that has already been lost? And now, again, they are not at all following the rules and regulations. They are thinking that the man who will fit this stake, they will punish him. Now, see what happened. And the servants were immediately sent all over the town looking for a man who would fit the stake. So now, the bailiffs, the soldiers, they were sent in all directions, in all parts of the kingdom to find a man who will fit this stake. Now, see whom they find. And their eyes fell on a disciple who had fattened himself for months on bananas, rice, wheat, and ghee. Finally, they have come to find a man fat enough who will fit the stake. And who was that man? He was the disciple. Okay, why? Because he has turned out to be a fat man because he was eating a number of, you can say, what he was eating? He was eating number of bananas, ghee and all that, right? So, when the soldiers, they have caught him, he said, what I have done wrong? I'm innocent. I'm a sannyasi, he cried. He cried, why are you taking me to the court? I have done nothing. There is nothing fault of mine. I am a sannyasi. How can I commit a crime? I am doing nothing. That may be true, but it's the royal decree. Decree means royal order, law. That we should find a man fat enough to fit the stake, they said, and carried him to the palace, to the place of execution. So finally, what happened? They said, of course, you may be not the criminal, but actually this is the law by the king, that we have to find a man who is fat enough and who should fit the stake of execution. He remembered his wise guru's words. This is the city of fools. You don't know what they all will do next. So now at that moment, he remembered the words of his guru. Yes, my guru has said that you will never come to know what they will do to you, because this is a kingdom of fools. So ultimately means this chapter, it highlights the message of unpredictable nature of the fools. And it is very difficult. It is not with your, you can say, intelligence only you can tackle them, but with your wisdom also. Okay, you have to find clever means in order to tackle these kind of fools. So, next, while he was waiting for death, he prayed to his guru in his heart, asking him to hear his cry wherever he was. Now, it was time for his execution. But before that, the person is trying to find each and every possible way out. When he found that nothing is at all possible, he was praying to Guru in his heart. Oh dear Guru, please come and save me. Now, see, the Guru saw everything in a vision. So Guru has magical vision. He saw everything what was happening to my disciple. He had magic powers. He could see far. He could see the future as he could see the present and the past. So he can see both the things. He arrived at once to save his disciple who had got himself into such a scrape through love of food. Scrape means this difficult situation. So Guru saw everything and he can also see the future. So he arrived at the point where the disciple was, and who had got himself into trouble just because of his love for food. Now, as soon as he arrived, he scolded the disciple and told him something in a whisper. So now, Guru had a complete plan in his mind. What he has done, he has come to disciple and he whispered something in his ears that nobody was able to listen. Then he went to the king and addressed him, "O wisest of kings, who is greater, the guru or the disciple?" So now, after that, the guru went to the king. He said, "O wise king, please tell me one thing, that who is greater, me or my disciple?" "Of course," the guru, "no doubt about it. And why do you ask?" King said, "There is no doubt. You are the guru, you are the greater than that of disciple. There is no doubt in it. But why are you asking this? Then put me to the stake first. Put my disciple to death after me." He said, "You are going to execute my disciple, but I request you, don't execute my disciple. Execute me first and after me, my disciple." Why? See, when the disciple heard this, he understood and began to clamor, "Me first." Clamor means they were starting fighting, shouting. So, disciple heard this, he understood. He said, "No, no, it's not him. Me first. First of all, execute me because I'm the culprit. You brought me here first. Put me to death first, not him. Just put me to death first, not him. Actually, I'm the culprit." The guru and the disciple now got into fight about who should go first. So they were fighting with each other. Who would be the first one to be punished? The king was puzzled by this behavior. King was puzzled that never ever in his life he has ever seen this kind of man. Okay, that who is fighting for his death? What is the reason behind it? He asked the guru, why do you want to die? We chose him because he needed a fat man, because we needed a fat man for the stake. He asked the guru, "Why are you fighting for death? We chose him. Actually, we needed a fat man who to be punished here. But why do you want to die? You shouldn't ask me such questions. Put me to death first," replied the guru. Guru said, "No, please, don't ask me these kind of questions, but please put me to death first. Why? There's some mystery here. As a wise man, you must make me understand. He said, of course, there's a mystery. You are a very wise man. First of all, make me clear that what is the mystery behind? So, will you promise to put me to death if I tell you? Asked the Guru. Guru, in a very, you can say, persuasive manner. He said, okay, I will tell you the mystery, but make a promise that after listening to the mystery, you will put me to stake. The king gave him his solemn word. King promised him. The Guru took him aside out of the servant's earshot and whispered to him, do you know why we want to die right now, the two of us? We have been all over the world, but we have never found a city like this or a king like you. Now the Guru, he took him aside from the other courtiers who were standing there so that they could not be able to listen what they were discussing. He said, actually, you know why I wanted to die? Let me tell you the reason. Me and my disciple, we have traveled across the world, but we have never found a such kind of kingdom. And we have never found this kind of stake. That stake is the stake of the God of justice. Whose stake is this? This is the stake of God of justice. And it's now, it's new. It has never had a criminal on it. And moreover, the important thing is it's new. No criminal had ever been punished here. Whoever dies on it first will be reborn as the king of this country. And whoever goes next will be the future minister of this country. So what he said, actually the person who will be dead first at this stake, when this person will be reborn again, he will be the king of this country. And the second person who will be dead at this stake, he will be reborn as the minister of this country. We are sick of ascetic life. Ascetic means saintly life. Okay? We are sick of this ascetic life, come preaching, going from one place to another. Now we want to live a life of rich people. It would be nice to enjoy ourselves as king and minister for a while. He said, actually, we also want to be the king and the minister and to enjoy this kind of life. It would be nice to enjoy ourselves. Now keep your word, my lord, and put us to death. Me first, remember. He said, sir, that's all. I have told you the truth. Now what you have to do? You have to put me to death first, and after my minister, that is your problem. But me first. So with this, the Guru has given another problem to the minister. So now tomorrow we will see what will happen as a result of this execution. Whether the Guru, he will be put to stake, or the disciple, or what happened. Okay. Finally, in the end, who will be dead? So this we will continue in the next lecture. Okay.